Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to the 2022 MIT LIDS Student Conference. I am Chirag Rao, and I have the honor and pleasure of introducing our plenary speaker for this afternoon. Professor Angelia Nedich holds a PhD from Moscow State University in computational mathematics and mathematical physics, as well as a PhD from MIT in electrical and computer science engineering. She has worked as a senior engineer in BAE Systems North America, the Advanced Information Technology Division in Burlington, Massachusetts. She is also the recipient of an SF Career Award in 2007 in operations research for her work in distributed multi-agent optimization. She is also a recipient, currently with her co-authors, of the Best Paper Award at the 2013 Winter Simulation Conference and the Best Paper Award at YOPT 2015. Also, she is a co-author of the book Convex Analysis and Optimization. Her current interest is in large-scale optimization, games, control, and information processing in networks. And with that, I hand over the floor to Professor Nedich. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Chirag, and thank you all. I'm actually extremely excited and a bit nervous because, well, 20 some years ago, I was sitting in the audience in a much smaller audience room, and we were organizing, I don't remember, was it fourth or fifth LIDS conference at the time. So I feel extremely honored to be on the side when I can talk about things I have done in between. And I will be talking about actually the work that started almost 15 years ago, and off and on, I was returning to it. And we will talk about distributed, typically we think large scale problems that we want to solve over networks, where the multiple entities are communicating, and one has to resolve an issue with the scale and decentralization as well. So I don't have nice pictures to kind of showcase what kind of possible applications there are, but I'm largely thinking of problems that arise in automatic control systems, and in particular in robot networks. And this is where I don't have a particular application that I'm really working on, but I have colleagues, and with these robotic networks, I get to learn a lot from my colleague and friend, Stephanie Gill, that she does some fantastic things, and I'm just thinking about things I can help her with. There are also envisioned future energy systems that talk about distributed generators and of course, various kind of users. There are envisioned future smart grids and smart cities, and all of these kind of applications will have quite a lot of many of these devices that will require a lot of decentralized computations. Signal and image processing were probably among the first long time ago that they were looking at certain, for the fusion systems, they were looking at decentralized approaches. And nowadays what happens with this data or data mining or learning, there are actually another collection of source problems where this distributed, I think I have my email open. If you give me just a second, I have to shut it down because it's not, I don't want to disturb us. All right. So these when we are training the neural nets in the training stage, these algorithms can be useful, especially when the data is collected at multiple locations. So I will go with that little example of machine learning problem, where, for example, we typically have the problems in machine learning come from collecting a lot of data, and every data will give us a constraint. So this is this collection of, I'm just arbitrarily using some function G to model the data points. And then M is in this case rather large. And typically we introduce some regularizers in order to guide what kind of solutions we want. So sometimes we are concerned with sparsity, sometimes it's Euclidean norm because it has nice properties. And as a particular choices, for example, when we are working with linear classifiers, these functions assume particular form. This is just a one stylized problem. So the curse here with these problems comes mainly with a large number of constraints. And otherwise, meaning all the theory exists, algorithms are there, but they cannot cope with the size of the problem. So generically, kind of, if you look around, what are the strategies that have been adopted to look at and develop algorithms to solve the problems, I roughly group them kind of in a two groups. One is the penalty-based reformulation, which typically says, it's in essence, it's replacement of the original problem. It's not always equivalent to the original problem, but it says, okay, let's just come up with alternative model where we're gonna bring these constraints into the objective. So we're gonna face a particular, a problem with a particular structure. Second is maybe less popular because it's still in the development. There are techniques that can resort to sampling of these constraints. So either you sample once a large collection of constraints and formulate a form of sampled problem, and then you investigate properties and things like that. Or you may decide to design an algorithm that can do the sampling as you are moving through the iterations. So I'm going to focus today, actually, for this network side, on the first version of the of these approaches, where you reformulate the problem, and you end up seeing. I'm going to skip this slide because this just says how we do that typically. Well, for each of the points in the that is defining our constraints, we can come up with a certain loss function. Then in this equation two, this is where we are bringing all the constraints penalized through loss functions in essence, and constructing alternative problem. And we also introduce this regularization parameter R, which kind of talks about trade-offs, how much I care about my type of the, let's say in a classifier problem where I'm looking at the sparse classifier, how much I'm trading between fitting the data, actually minimizing the loss, versus how much I care about sparsity. So that's a tuning parameter. Typically it's run multiple, problem is solved multiple times with tweaking the raw to understand the trade-off. But I'm here focusing on just a part of this problem, and you say, okay, we can basically put this, give the same classifier for that particular example, specification of the raw function, we can give it to all of these elements, all of the elements that come from the constraints. So generically, that problem can be looked at from this endpoint, like I'm minimizing an average of some of the functions where M is now large. And I'm not going to focus on anything that involves constraints, or because I want to just discuss some of the basic ideas that went into development of the algorithm. So I'm not going to put any layers of complexity in that. And then looking at this problem, we can look back as probably 40, maybe even 50 years ago. People had looked at these problems for different reasons. It actually came from a support vector machine at the time and neural nets as well. Except M now today is much larger than that it was then. And there have been developed many kind of approaches that one of the approaches was incremental. So you basically you're gonna process one component at a time, and there is a vast literature in that direction. And particularly Professor Betsekas had a lot of work done in that area. My thesis was in that area, focused on non-smooth problems of this kind. And one of the success stories from that approach when you do incremental is when you introduce these random incremental, where you're basically sampling from the collection of the functions. And the most recent developments in that direction brought these stochastic, they refer to that as a stochastic gradient method. The recent success stories are actually developing models that basically build on this stochastic sampling idea by actually bringing other tools to reduce the variance. And then we have seen a I'm mentioning here few of those, but there have been developments of many algorithms that look into these various reduced gradient type methods like SVRG, SAG, SAGA, Katyusha, and so on. So when I'm thinking of how these problems are coming, when you are solving them, whether you do incremental random, what you're looking at is really, I'm looking at computational model. Computational model corresponds to something we kind of refer to as master-slave. There is a central node that's going to be responsible for maintaining the decision variable, and this random selection of which component will be processed next, regardless which, whether you are looking at the simpler version of the of these gradient methods or these advanced versions that require more memory. The scenario is really, you have workers that are purple nodes here, and each of them is only able to, meaning responsible for computing the gradient of their own objective function. So then in this scenario, master node is still a central entity. It coordinates because it is the one responsible for the decision. It selects randomly one worker, and worker gets to compute gradient data. It's sent back to the master node upstate. So it's sometimes you can think it's not necessarily a node. It could be a memory where the decision variable X is stored. And then by some random process, you're allowing one worker to get rid of the content in that memory space, update and update X and leave. So these algorithms, so there is a language kind of that goes often in different literature. The word distributed is used to mean different things. So in this case, we can think this is distributed because we are distributing the work among the nodes. There are workers and there is some master kind of center, but however, it's centralized because there is some place where the data is either centralized or somebody who orchestrates these computations. So all of these algorithms that go from these SVRG saga and so on belong to this class because they do require this central entity. Now there is a variant of the incremental methods that is both distributed because the work is distributed among the nodes, and it's also decentralized because it doesn't have a central entity that coordinates actions. That model is actually this cyclic incremental method, which if one looks at how the information goes, pretty much you have M workers or M nodes. Each of them operates on their own objective. Each one is assigned a single function, and the nodes are organized in a cycle. So every node receives the update of the decision from its upstream neighbor. It's going to process its own component, which means gradient step, and it's passing it down the cycle to the next node. So this was the original kind of incremental method if you want to really look at the flow of the information. And the two shortcomings that are now present in this model, yes, it's decentralized in terms of no node has particular role. They're all about the same, no central entity to coordinate. But the shortcomings were, especially when M is really large, it takes a long time to make the pass through the data. For one cycle, it can be M is very long, so it takes a long time to complete a single cycle. Single cycle corresponds to usually the decision that you'd like because it requires, it's updating according to the all of the data. Now, another kind of shortcoming is actually these cycles that we organize the nodes to compute are often also vulnerable to various kind of meaning failures. If the link fails, cycle is broken, you have to reconstruct cycle again. Or if the node fails, the same situation happens. So that kind of simple cycle motivates what we're going to discuss now. You can think cycle was like information connection, it could be the network that was connecting, communication network that was allowing nodes to talk to each other. So the alternative is now, what if you remove the cycle and just replace it for the with an arbitrary now the cycle was directed. I'm not going to worry about directions at the moment. It could have been undirected, but it's typically directed for these incremental methods. So I'm going to think of, imagine replacing that cycle with just undirected graph for time being, where somehow nodes are connected, meaning we are not worried. I'm assuming typically these networks and connectivities are given to us, depends on the application, but I assume that agents are now embedded into communication network. Links are undirected for time being, but their goal is to solve the same problem. In the prior slide, I may have had 1/m there. It's not big difference because that problem, when I use the actual average or the sum equivalent to each other in sense of their solutions are the same, values are not, but solutions are. So we are facing pretty much the same exact problem, but now there are different constraints that are involved in terms of how the information is shared. What is in this setting is, I'm going to give more specific details of kind of assumptions I'm making, but typically I'm going to work with convex functions. I'm going to think of them. And now every agent is going to have this objective function, which is completely privately known by that agent. What that means is that agent is not going to try to share the information with any other agent in the network where the function is going to get revealed. In one of the particular problems where this is really the case is these machine learning problems. Remember that these functions that we get constructed here, you can think they get constructed because, let's say, node 5 has its own measurement, it has some collected data. The data defines the objective function. So if a node 5 wants to inform the other node about the objective, it means it has to pretty much give all the data points to the other node, which is unacceptable, especially because there are many applications where this data is private. Nobody wants to share the data. So in this scenario, that's exactly assumptions I want to make. Privately known objectives, sometimes they could be utilities. You also don't want to disclose them. I prefer minimization, but you can easily toss the problem to maximization. And then the goal is now to mimic what happened in the incremental case. No central authority. Everybody, so what is going to be happening? We're going to minimize in this network jointly using all the nodes to solve the sum of the objective minimization. However, to compensate for that lack of central entity, we're going to allow the nodes to talk to each other locally. Locally, I refer to the case when node can talk to the immediate neighbors as we see them in a graph, like one hop neighbors. And I'm going to refer to them distributedly. Sometimes they call them decentralized methods. I refer to them as distributed. And the assumption is that nodes do know their neighbors. So they know with whom they can talk, and they have some limited information. They are willing to exchange with each other to help each other and solve this problem. Nice thing here is that actually that no agent even needs to know the graph. Every agent just needs to have a local view of the graph. Second, no knowledge of M is either needed. None of these agents are necessarily equipped with the knowledge of the total, even how many of them are on the network. And to do that, it turns that you can replace this lack of, so we need basically to allow these agents to solve the problem in such a distributed kind of information setting. We need a mechanism to sort of align them. And that alignment happens to come from the Groot model. And I'm going to focus on that model for the most part with some variations, which is really used for, has been used for alignment of opinion originally. In the 80s, Professor Tsitsiklis actually has a thesis done in that direction, which was tremendously influential, as well as this paper by Tsitsiklis, Persekas, and Athens, that they are using this De Groot model to solve an optimization problem, but optimization problem has a completely different structure. problem has a one objective function where different agents work on different decision variables. However, that was, seeing that gave us, at the time when me and Professor Ozdala were looking at this, it gave us idea that it seems it's gonna work for this as well. Because if you're aligning, if you're using these alignments and the process of optimization is right, then eventually agreement is happening and optimization kicks in to kind of lead to the solutions. So to do that, I'm gonna go a little bit into what are the pieces of the theory that enter into this model. Of course, optimization, there is a theory and algorithms, but this consensus itself turns out to be something that's very rich. It borrows from graph theory, and it's not complicated. It just borrows the basic concepts of graphs, connectivities, and a little now depends how we work with them. They can go into Laplacian and spectral properties. Because this consensus model relies on some particular mixing, it turns out those are some matrices that we know them as row stochastic, column stochastic, or both. Those now tools to analyze them on a static case is relatively easy. That the time varying case becomes difficult when the agents communicate the graph is changing the structure. It actually goes to look at the literature that talks about on behavior of the products of non-negative matrices and or Markov chain. So you can look at both directions too. Basically, those are the building blocks. With the putting them all together, the model kicks in. So I'm not gonna, I will assume you more or less, you are familiar with the basic graphs. That's something we get definitely going through LIDS. But I would just focus on actually the red words. What I mean by that is, for me, graph is now is gonna be given, and it's gonna, the way I'm gonna interpret it is it's not just its communication, it's also information flow. It's gonna tell me how the information is moving through the graph. So graph is modeling the information, how it flows. And we'll look at two particular, meaning situations where the graph is undirected and connected. That's one case. And the other case is situation is somewhat different when the graph is actually directed. Then we'll assume it's strongly connected, but there will be issues that arise there that do not happen with the basically undirected graph. With that, some of the notation that you will see, I don't want to bring it on the slide, every slide it comes down, is sort of, it's a standard that if we talk about undirected graphs, that N sub I will denote a neighborhood, one hop neighborhood of the agent I. Literally says, take all the nodes that can directly talk, that are connected in the graph with the agent I. For the directed graphs, the situation is a bit different because we have directional kind of information flow. You need to identify two types of neighbors. The neighbors that we refer to as in neighbors, those are neighbors who can send the information to agent I. And the out neighbors are those that the agent I can reach with the directed links down the stream. And another thing that I'm going to assume for the rest of the slides is that because I'm thinking of this as information, kind of graph contains the information, basically who knows what, who is connected to who, and it's information access, because every agent is always aware of its own decisions, it has access to its own information. All the graphs I'm going to consider will always have self loops. We can define things differently, but I prefer to say, okay, it's access to your own information. It assumes that actually, in that case, every agent is a member of all of these neighbor sets, depending on which situation you are. It's always included. Now, I'm going to briefly maybe go because time is running faster than I want. But what is the De Groot model? So all it takes is just to look at the picture. In the De Groot model, graph is directed or not, is not that critical. It really says that agent six, I'm looking at what agent six is doing. Agent six is going to send to all of its neighbors its state. So let's say at time t, this is the state. And what is going to do with the incoming information is much more important. For every of the upstream neighbors from which the agent receives the values, the decisions, at the moment t, at the time t, it's going to give a particular weights. They are labeled here a bit WWW. All of these weights are positive. There is also a self loop, and that weight is also positive. So we construct pretty much an agent will have a row kind of weights that are positive if somebody is a neighbor and zero if they are not. So I'm going to need to speed up here to come to this basically metrics. Matrix form of the consensus model. Here, as I said, W ethrow is controlled by agent I, with values being zero if somebody is not a neighbor. So the matrix captures both the weights and the structure of the graph. And then matrix is non-negative, weights add up to one, which means your matrix is row stochastic. You obtain a simple linear process. And then the behavior of that process really depends on what the behavior of this matrix W to the power of T is as T goes to infinity. Now you can, this is the moment when you can think, okay, I can interpret W as just a transition matrix of some stationary Markov chain, borrow the theory from there and come up with a conclusion that there will be a limit. This process will have a limit because of the matrices. The limit is going to be such that all of the agents will agree on will reach the same value in the limit. But for the optimization part, that's not actually sufficient. If you want to build anything on this consensus model, basically what I'm referring is that you can put a game on solving a game and using consensus to help you align or optimization. It's very important to understand, it turns out, it's important to understand the speed at which this agreement process is actually happening, what we call convergence rate. So to do that, there is we borrow tricks from actually non-negative matrix theory. One can resort to reversible Markov chains, that's our alternative. But what you come up is using some properties of this matrix and the left eigenvector, associated value one, you can design, you actually come up with a particular norm in which you're going to measure and look how this process is shrinking toward the consensus point. And then a leading kind of the term that comes to dictate this rate is really what I denoted here by rho sub w. That's really the second largest in modulus eigenvalue of the w. That dictate, that's really depending on the graph and on the weights. I'm not focusing the direction of what's the best W to choose. It's really an open question. So for now, it's the same as asking what's the fastest Markov chain if you gave me a graph. There are works, but there is no actual answer. There are just models that cast it as an optimization. So let me see what I'm going to. Okay, I'm going to skip this because this is basically saying I like to, because I come from optimization background. Even consensus in the group dynamic, I typically ask, what is the dynamic really doing? I usually believe there is an underlying optimization problem or a feasibility problem that particular dynamic or algorithm that people design, it must be solving it. And it turns out that actually, if somebody gave you a graph, and these agents choose these matrices, they are jointly solving this equation here. They are jointly in the system, they want to find a vector X or a matrix, if their decisions are vectors, they want to solve this equation. It's a really, what I call it, fixed point. Now, interesting is that basically, okay, so we got the picture of saying, if now that we understand what consensus model, the group model is doing, next thing was to see if, can we have a, what is happening with time-varying graphs? So in the static case, solving that equation Wx equals x, agents manage, depending on the W, to reach a solution of that equation. And that solution of that equation is any vector or a matrix, depends in which space you are. That is called that all the rows are the same if it's a matrix. If it's a vector, then all the entries in that vector are the same. So the question is now, what if that's the case, what's happening when you are solving, looking at time-varying graphs? It turns out that actually, and again, I'm going to go quickly to just that point. It turns out that at time when they communicate, they are solving this equation now. If the graph is changing, Wt is reflective of the graph, still satisfies these properties that it's graph compatible. And when these graphs over which they communicate are connected, what happens, actually strongly connected here because I'm not yet in optimization, what happens is that as if you're solving the same equation, solutions to these equations are the same as in the graph, when the graph was static, but what happens is that your algebraic description is different at a different time t. And that, but the solution is set is the same. So that was actually the most, probably most important part of, in terms of understanding how we're going to address the time varying cases. It's really saying your set of that you want on which you want to reach a solution is the same, description is different. So that's a good news. So by doing that, now going back to the problem originally that we said, what we did originally many years ago, we constructed a very simple algorithm that just mimics in the decision space, mimics consensus, the Groot model. And in the desire to solve the optimization problem, we allow every agent to move just along the direction of its own gradient. And we have results. I'm not going to bother you with that. Algorithm would work, can reach, all the agents can reach a common solution. All of them will agree on a solution of the problem. But there is one detail here, is that critical condition under which this will happen is that every agent has to be equally influential. So I'm again thinking of static graph. Time varying case really goes through this sequence of matrices, just basically non-homogeneous Markov chain. That's just an extension. I'm back to the standard, the first one, when graph is fixed, to just think about what is the critical property that I need for the method to work. When we say every agent equally influential, we are thinking of steady state distribution of that Markov chain. Every agent equally influential means the steady state distribution is uniform. But on other side, one of the assumptions one can make is that the matrix W is doubly stochastic, and you have ways of constructing it. So even if the graph is changing, you can construct it on the go by exchanging a little more information, but that's something that was indispensable. And that kind of shows to one limitation. It says, well, that will work if your graph is undirected, because balancing these matrices to be doubly stochastic, it's not gonna be easy if your graph is directed and changing with time. So the alternative to resolve that question is to say, look around, and there is an alternative to consensus model which does something else. I'm gonna not focus, there is a lot of, meaning you can look at this literature if you're interested in. I'm gonna just focus, there is some light kind of discussion of what it happens, motivating this kind of alternative model, but I'm gonna focus only on this slide here, because here is something that we're gonna use to build something that accelerates. So from this, in this setting, as we said, we need now, we are looking now at directed graphs, because the Groot model works for the just consensus, but if we want to optimize, it cannot work on it doesn't work on directed graphs because it requires some balancing, which can be time consuming. So what we look here is something different. We are thinking of this push sum method, which is alternative, on the directed graph. What the agents do here is very different. So I'm focusing only on the consensus kind of version of that model. From the standpoint of the what agent six and all other agents are doing when they are sending the information, now they are not just sending their decisions like in the prior case. Actually, the agent six will be now has a value one. It's like a total weight that it's broken into some portions depending on how many out neighbors it has, and it's also counting itself. And every of its neighbors is going to get a portion of the two variables, actually, of the decision and something that does sort of a form of bias cancellation. The important part is to focus that these agent six, by basically doing these decisions on the weights C76, C86, it's kind of fractions of the total mass of one that's going to multiply the decision and just push it down. By doing that, agent six is now constructing the column in the matrix six, this matrix C, where the sixth column is normal, is actually, or weights are non-negative, compatible with the graph, and also they add up to one. So it's a column stochastic. Or different thing happens with the information that reaches these agents, because these now agent six is deciding on these weights. What comes from these upstream neighbors, it's a similar version. They kind of chop their, they form their portions, but the agent six is just adding up the received values. So the quantity, this is really decision variable. So it's just adding up whatever of the decisions was received from the upstream neighbors. And this variable, it's a scalar typically, it's really used to eliminate the bias. Details are in the couple prior slides, but you can look at that. So it's the same, it's basically repetition of the same process. It's just these guys could be vectors, these guys are not, the second wise. And the points that if the consensus where it's reached, it's really the ratio of the it's this vector divided by the second process that mimics. This process will reach a consensus on the initial average, provided that variables yi are all started initially set up to value one for every agent. So this is this so-called push sum. Push because you are really dividing, controlling the column, and sum because what comes to you as an agent, you're just adding. I'm not going to talk about push sum method because, again, it's what we did now is just, okay, now we have directed graphs, time varying, replaced the consensus, the Groot model with this more complicated model, and just build an algorithm optimization part on it. The literature is here if you're interested in looking at that, but the bottom line for both of these algorithms, it was really the most kind of, the most negative thing about these models is that they will work, they will be slow. Slow means they're going to converge that rate 1 over t at most, if you think of t as number of your iterations. But they have no ability to match the best performance of the centralized methods, for example, where your functions have smoothness properties and strong convexity properties, you cannot reach the geometric rate. And that was one of the... I'm sorry, I just need to make sure my battery is running low. Okay, so the problem is that you cannot accelerate them. You cannot accelerate them. So the last 3-4 years, maybe a little more, we were actually trying to resolve that issue. So when you look back, what happens if you look at this simple De Groot kind of driven dynamic or algorithm, it turns out that we want jointly to solve this problem in using all the agents. They want to help each other because they just know we're going to tell them what to do. They collaborate on the decision, but directions in which they're moving are completely selfish. There is no collaboration on the direction. And this is the main reason for slowing down the processes. So the simple idea was to, just like you allow these agents to help each other with the decisions, allow them to help each other with the directions as well. What you are saying in essence is they are aware that objective function exists. They may not know it. So they need to collaborate and help each other estimate the gradients of the total sum. And that turns out to be a model that we refer to as a gradient tracking. We have a couple models of those. When you replace this selfish direction in which agent was updating to use a form of an estimate of what a system of gradient might be at the time, and then they update these by using, they exchange these directions, they update, mimicking perhaps the De Groot model, and they have this update term that to me looks very much like what Kalman filtering is doing. You are looking at the innovation because you don't want to repeat, you don't want to give them the entire vector, this, the first one, which is your recent update. You would like to subtract this past gradient you already gave them because it's already contained here. So you're gonna, what you really want to tell them is how much change I'm gonna see due to my update in the decision. And this turns out to work to reach the, to allow us to reach these best performance of the centralized methods to actually reach the geometric rate. And there is a lot of people who had worked here, including Lina, that actually she was one of the people who were among the first to look at the accelerations by using Nesterov method at gradient tracking, and her student Guanan. So I miss her yesterday. There's a lot of work here. That if you are interested in those directions, a lot of things have happened in many different groups. I'm not going to be able to talk about them. What I'm saying is now, well, this method that I just described uses the same matrices W for mixing the decisions and mixing the gradients. Problem with that is we are hitting the same issue with undirected graphs. It's not going to work because these matrices for that first version of digging was required to be doubly stochastic. So a few years later, one of my postdocs took a closer look into the model and realized that actually when we are mixing the decisions, we need matrix that's row stochastic. Column stochasticity there was not important. When you are mixing the directions, column stochasticity important, row stochasticity is not. So you kind of completely separated mixing for the decisions versus mixing for the gradients. And this at the end, now in this kind of separation of what's happening with this, one is only row stochastic, the other one is only column stochastic, issue with graph being directed or not doesn't occur. It just, it works on any of these graphs. However, analysis is kind of complicated. It's not as obvious, meaning it's pretty tricky. And until very recently, this method was not developed for time-varying graphs. So recently, I just, being absent from conferences, it was very hard to follow what people are doing. So I just randomly, I ran into the paper by Usman Khan, who's at Tufts, that actually in his group, they already had resolved this question, what happens if I want to implement this push-pull on time-varying graphs? It was just a matter of choosing the right metric. And I'm kind of getting close. I'm sorry, I had to rush. So what I'm looking for here now, the landscape with these approaches that currently people are looking at. And there are actually several directions. Non-convex problems are one of them. And I'm giving you just, instead of listing the papers, I'm just giving here a list of colleagues that I'm aware that in their groups, I see publications that are addressing those topics. Asynchronicity is one of the important parts, because for them, whenever we are developing these, we were developing these initial first kind of models, we assumed that time is synchronized. So every agent is kind of having a same clock, which is aligned, and they know when to talk to each other. That's not realistic. And also, there are situations where the network is not stable. Links may fall, meaning failure may happen. So there are other models that address these issues that either resort to randomness to kind of use the random network or random graph model to allow for, to analyze what happens with these cases when you cannot do it, when you're not synchronizing updates. How the network topology is very critical. It affects how the process is moving, both consensus and the optimization. And there are people here, including Alex. Alex is also one of our LIDS graduates. And we collaborated a lot, but he is particularly interested in scaling and looking at algorithms that have a polynomial convergence behavior in terms of the number of the agents on the graph. Impact of delays is another issue, which comes from realistic applications. Privacy has been lately been also, and it comes from these, I think, problems we are seeing with these applications from machine learning. That sometimes, because your data is reflective of something you collected about customers, patients, or things like that, you are trying to, and when you are, if you're doing this optimization kind of distributedly, even though you don't want to reveal your data, there could be that somebody's listening and maybe collecting the data or information you are sending on a link and somehow tries to reconstruct particular things that might be sensitive. So there's one of my colleagues that I'm aware of. I'm pretty much sure there are many more, but I'm aware of his work, which is on the distributed setting. There are privacy in other domains, but in the decentralized distributed optimization, he's the one who does that. And finally, we lately started looking at something that is also connected to, like if you think of the deployment of any future systems that might be using even just a basic consensus as a method of agreeing on something, whether it's a direction where they're gonna move or it's a location where they're gonna meet. We assume an ideal case that every agent is gonna always behave according to the rules that are given to them. The reality is in some of the applications, it's very natural to assume that actually some of these agents will fail, whether they're due to some physical kind of malfunctioning, or it could be somebody who's actually attacking your system and they're gonna deploy malicious behavior. Basically, they're gonna try to prevent you from correct computations. And there is there's a list of people that I'm aware of that they are working on this topic. And basically that's the group that I have joined lately to investigate, understand, and actually kind of from the consensus side, many things have been done, but not only optimization. Actually, the similar concept appears even in federated learning lately under the name of, I think, Byzantine behavior. So it's very, very much aligned into that direction. And with that, I want to thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for giving me a chance to be here.
Thank you, Professor Nedich. That was a wonderful talk. At this time, if anyone in the audience has any questions, please feel free to either type them into the chat or you can use the raise hand button under the reactions feature. We'll start off with a question from the chat here from Shan Yuan. Professor, in your model, you mentioned agents are communicating limited information to its immediate neighbors. It's limiting its information to the nearest neighbors. Is this information transmission adaptive or optimized over some communications constraints on the graph?
No. This is ideal case when you think, I was thinking of what is the minimal information in terms of information for optimization to work. So in that, that's a decision, that's a direction. Reality is, in these models, we assume you can send real numbers across the link, which is not realistic at all. So there are works that look into quantization, and there are some, and other the quantization is fixed, which seems like when a model is just a model of a link that doesn't change. And there are models that actually, this question is actually asking, that do try to optimize. In what sense is that initially this quantization could be rather crude, and as they are getting over time closer in some, they are trying to improve on the quantization level to kind of get more information. So I would call that, meaning it's not maybe optimized, but it is adaptive. So I have not done work in that direction, but I know Professor Bashar at U of I has been doing some work there on along those lines with one of his PhD students, Rasul Etesami, I believe. And also there is earlier work by Shrikant. They were looking at quantization effects for gossip algorithms, for example, which is a particular model for alignment. But not me.
Are there any other questions for Professor Nedich? Okay, I see Rabab has her hand raised. Rabab, feel free to unmute yourself and ask your question.
Thank you. Hi, Professor. This was a wonderful presentation, so thank you for this. I'm actually working on some applications of distributed optimization with Dr. Nuanaswamy, and particularly in the energy system. So we've had some work in terms of privacy preservation for our algorithms, but I was wondering if you could comment a little bit more on the work that you're doing in the presence of malicious agents, especially because that is something very applicable within our domain.
Yeah, that's actually very recent work with Professor Stephanie Gill, with Michal Yemini at Princeton and Andrea Goldsmith at Princeton. So what we work, it's, okay. So what we do in the model, it's somewhat different. What there are, I would say, roughly two basic approaches, how you model these malicious behavior. So in the literature, the typically, either they use a robust consensus or they were, the word goes resilient consensus, it goes under both names. They assume that somehow the agents will be deployed in an unfriendly environment. Now, regardless of what that environment is, they come up with an algorithm that tries to guard against the possible malicious behavior. But it doesn't try to respond in any other ways, like pre-design policy that they're gonna be deploying it. And the difficult part there is typically to characterize the point because of the process, how they do it. It's hard to identify what is precisely the consensus they're agreeing on. They can tell you roughly the region, that's why they use the word robust, but they cannot really pinpoint more than that. So with this work that we just started maybe about a year ago, Stephanie has actually something that was just right. She was saying that sometimes these channels over which the agents are talking, there is additional information in the channel from which you may extract how truthful the agents really are. It's really like a statistical model that allows you to learn over time. So you will collect the certain kind of variable, you're gonna see the observations of some random variable, and kind of what you would do in hypothesis testing, you can use it to help you understand how likely this agent is truthful versus not. And then building on all of that, you can come up with a much more flexible framework, which is maybe harder to analyze, because what the agents are now doing using these statistics that they are gathering over the channels, they are also adjusting the weights. So the agents that they are trust, they believe they are trustworthy, they'll give them larger weight, this W that I had. And the agents that seems deceptive, they're gonna lower the values of W. So in that sense, the analysis becomes a bit trickier, because now you get the graph, meaning graph could be fixed, but because of this learning of the malicious behavior, your matrices are now time varying, they are random, but you are able using the, now depending on what statistical model you have been using for learning, that's the, now the power of Michal Yemini, she comes with these all concentration inequalities you can use, and then you can tell. You can kind of characterize the point of consensus. You can say how much the point that you reach consensus deviates from the one that you would have achieved if you didn't have bad malicious agents. And you can also characterize the rate. Everything is probabilistic. So it's a slightly different direction in which we are looking. And I'm excited because we basically, there are tools that are a little bit more exciting, because I have a chance to learn.
Thank you so much.
Do we have any more questions for Professor Nedich?
There's one in the chat from Vishal.
Yeah, I see two.
Oh, I see now. Okay. All right. So Vishrant is asking, is there a way to incorporate settings that are not consensus-based, but still benefit from distributed optimization? In other words, information from neighbors improves the choice at each node, but each node could converge to different vectors that are more suited to their local cost function.
Okay.
For example, personalized federated learning.
Yeah, I see. Okay, so I have to, you know, to be very kind of fair. I heard of federated learning. I know very little about it. So I cannot specifically answer the question that goes into this word personalized federated learning. But I can see it is, of course, doable. The one way I can see it is that in these other possibilities, you might think, it doesn't have to be optimization. It can be a game. So, or maybe team optimization. What I'm referring here is that, to me, game seems like one of these scenarios. We're gonna help each other to some extent, but we are all gonna go to our own best decisions. In the game, they are constrained on what the others are doing. Here, it might not be. So it is possible to do that. I don't know, depends on particular problem that's there. Maybe there is absolutely no need for consensus. Maybe it has to do with, if I'm a user, and maybe one of you is my neighbor, maybe if we are kind of tied through some common variable, then we can kind of help each other. But I'm gonna still worry about my personalized objective, the other agents of their own, but it could be some useful exchange for the reasons that they just both benefit in some way. So there are works that go in that direction, but I cannot really give up any better comment that can really address this personalized learning.
Okay, with that, in the interest of time, this concludes our plenary talk. Thank you so much, Professor Nedich, for joining us and giving your talk. We will now have a quick coffee break, and we'll resume our student talks at 3:15 p.m. with our session on algorithms and optimization. So we'll see you all soon at 3:15 p.m. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a wonderful day. Thank you.
Thank you.